and thank you all for your patience. I'm Richard Haass. I'm president of the Council on Foreign Relations, and I want to welcome you all tonight to the Council for this year's David A. Morse Lectureship. The Morse Lecture was inaugurated a decade ago in 1994. David Morse, who was a distinguished lawyer and public servant, was an energetic and committed council member for more than 30 years, which is a period only somewhat longer than the 22 years he served as Director General of the International Labor Organization. And indeed, it was during his extraordinary tenure there that he accepted the Nobel Peace Prize on behalf of the ILO. The Morse Lectureship was established appropriately enough, and I quote, to honor a public servant of great integrity and distinction. And it is difficult to imagine an individual more fitting than tonight's speaker, Kofi Annan. Mr. Annan, as I expect you know, was born in Ghana, but then educated to a considerable extent in this country. He spent more than 40 years in the UN system, becoming the 7th Secretary General on 1 January 1997. We are fortunate that he's taken time out here during his second term as Secretary General to be with us. He actually had a long speech prepared, but because we're somewhat late, I've asked him to dispense with it. Seriously, we've taken the liberty of departing from the normal pattern of the Morse Lectureship, and there won't be a long talk tonight. Instead, what we thought we'd do in order to allow us to cover a bit more ground is we'll begin with a conversation between the Secretary General and myself, and then we will open it up to you all, to members of the Council. Let me just make clear also at the outset that tonight's event obviously is on the record. And I'd also like to note that it's being broadcast, or rather webcast live, on the Council's website, cfr.org. Let me also at this point just ask all of you to check if you've got your cell phones or beepers or other mechanical devices, if you could shut them off, we would all be forever grateful. Mr. Secretary General, welcome.
Thank you very much, Richard. Let me first start by apologizing for being late. It's not my practice, but I'm sure the chairman and the president probably explained to you why. But let me thank you very much, Richard, for the honor of asking me to join you tonight to give this lecture, a sort of a lecture, in the memory of David Morse, whom I had the chance of knowing from the distance when we both worked in Geneva. He was at the ILO and I was a junior officer in the UN family. And I think it is wonderful to be able to do this in the presence of his wife, Mildred, who is here with us tonight. But I do hope none of you will feel shortchanged because I'm not giving a lecture and we're going to have a conversation and also give you a chance to ask me the questions which may be on your minds rather than hear me droning on about something that you may not want to hear about. Let me begin by perhaps repeating something that I said last September at the UN General Assembly when it opened. I said, I think we have reached a fork in the road, not just in the history of the United Nations, but in the history of the world since 1945. None of us is pretending that everything had gone smoothly in the world from 1945 until a year or two ago. But there were certain broadly shared understandings based on the United Nations Charter. States were supposed to use force only in self-defense or by a collective decision that it was necessary to use force in order to keep the peace. When force was used in circumstances other than those, it was generally condemned, or at least the people doing it felt they had to explain and justify it as something exceptional, which they would normally not do. Now we have a different situation. We have a different situation in the sense that we have one group of states led by the United States that is saying that some threats, particularly terrorism and weapons of mass destruction, are so dangerous that they dare not wait until they are attacked or until there is agreement in the Security Council before taking action. Another group, meanwhile, is saying that it is even more dangerous to have states using force at their own discretion, and that for most people in the world today, they feel much more directly threatened by other things such as poverty, hunger, disease, environmental degradation, or by low-tech violence when order breaks down in their countries or civil war breaks out. We saw what happened in Somalia, we saw what happened in Rwanda, and we know what we are confronted with to some extent in Haiti. That is why last November I appointed a high-level panel of very experienced men and women to try and help us forge a new consensus. First, on what the threats and challenges are that we are facing in this new century. And secondly, to advise us on policies and institutional changes that can be introduced to improve how we deal with these threats. I hope the panel will help us forge a new global consensus, or if we wish, a compact on what these threats are, so that we can get away from the idea that some threats, such as terrorism and weapons of mass destruction, are a concern to the countries of the North, while poverty, hunger only affect people in the South. I think we need a clear global understanding of the threats and challenges we face so that we can all find a way of dealing with them together and not neglect any one of them that might fatally undermine our efforts in other areas. But I also hope that the panel will go further than that and recommend specific changes in our policies and institutions, including the UN itself, to enable us to forge a really convincing collective response to the challenges that we are going to be facing or we face in this century. One of the members of the panel is Brent Scowcroft, who is well known to many of you here. Others are similarly experienced and knowledgeable and distinguished people from around the world. They will report to me before the end of this year so that I can make recommendations to the General Assembly and leave the member states to take the decisions. It is those member states through their governments who will ultimately make those decisions, but people like those in this audience and institutions like the Council on Foreign Relations have a vital contribution to make. And luckily, the panel is not approaching this work as a closed-door exercise and is open to ideas from many quarters. You can feed your ideas and suggestions into the work of the panel, and then when the recommendations are made public, you can help generate interest in them, and I hope support for them, to make sure that decision makers, both in this country and elsewhere, take them seriously and make a real effort to reach agreement on the changes that would be needed. I think I should pause here and open it up and have this conversation and question and answer period. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let me, if I might, begin and try to dig down a little bit on some of the themes you mentioned, sir. Let me quote from a recent speech of yours. And you said, "I believe the main reason why some countries resort to unilateral action is that they do not have confidence that a collective response would be timely or effective. That, above all, is what we have to change. The answer, or part of the answer, may be some kind of new compact between the United States and the rest of the world, comparable to that forged by the great powers in 1945. Could you please elaborate a little bit? What's...
Yeah. No, what I have in mind, let's go back to 1945. At the end of the World War, the leaders came together to ensure that we don't live through the kind of wars and experience that disfigured our world, and came up with an approach based on the UN Charter, which defined the circumstances under which force could be used. And that was generally accepted. I think it had worked reasonably well for 58 years, even though imperfectly, it had more or less generally been accepted. We now live in a situation where we are no longer facing major or possible confrontation between the superpowers. There's only one superpower. We do not have possibility of major wars and confrontation between big countries and powers. We are facing different kinds of threats: terrorism, weapons of mass destruction, and the indirect ones of poverty, disease, and environmental degradation that I have discussed. The US has made it clear in its own policies that there are certain threats that it may have to act, and act alone, even if the council doesn't move fast enough. Everybody argues that we are facing new sets of threats, threats that had not been anticipated when the charter was written. And if that is the case, I think it is essential that we come to an understanding as to what these threats are and how we face them collectively. If indeed the instruments we have today are inadequate, how do we adapt them and bring them in line with the challenges that we are facing today? And when I talk of a new compact and a new consensus, I'm really here dealing with, I'm talking about an agreement and understanding that will be accepted by the weak and the powerful, each side knowing that some adjustments will have to be made. I would expect the panel to deal with issues like, when is intervention legitimate? Under what circumstances, what criteria, and how do we move ahead, and how do we organize ourselves to respond to these new threats? And I would hope that the US would engage seriously with the work of the panel, because we cannot have a consensus with the US outside it. We cannot have an approach where other countries are seen as trying to tie down Gulliver. That wouldn't work either. I don't think we can. It would also work if we have a situation where the US only uses the UN as and when it sees it. That also provokes other countries and divides other countries. So we need to come up with a new compact or consensus as to how we are going to deal with these threats, and hope that it will be generally acceptable, just as the 1945 compact was generally accepted. So let's develop international, let's adapt it, let's be realistic and see what we can come up with. So it's a big challenge I've given the panel, and I hope the member states will be open when the proposals come forward.
In your own tentative thinking, do you anticipate that there would be legitimate uses of military force that would go beyond self-defense?
I think we have the UN has not been a pacifist organization. We have authorized use of force before. It was the United Nations that authorized the use of force to get Iraq out of Kuwait. And it was unanimous. There was no questions. And so the fact that the UN and the Security Council did not vote for the last Gulf War should not be misinterpreted to mean that UN is averse to force, use of force under any circumstances.
But again, well, the 1990-1991 case was a classic case of self-defense.
It was a classic case.
Can you imagine cases where we would have a broader definition of legitimate use of force than is now found, for example, in Article 51?
I see what you... No, that is possible, and this is one of the reasons why I think this panel's work is so important. I think most of us agree that in today's world you can have situation where take weapons of mass destruction. It can get into the wrong hands, into hands of terrorists and a terrorist group that may not hesitate to use it. And if one knows that this is the case, you are not going to wait for them to do it. But it has to be real, imminent, and real for one to react. And I think not only should one react, but also act often collective interest is also the national interest. I've been following what happened in Madrid a few days ago, and I find it very interesting that that attack has brought the European countries together in their decision to cooperate in their fight against terrorists. I mean, you're going to have a whole series of meetings, all the Europeans interior ministers are going to meet, the foreign ministers are going to meet, and the European Council is going to meet on terrorism and how they work together to fight it and to contain it. And that, I believe, is one of the most important approaches in fighting terrorism.
Just today, sir, you had a column in the Wall Street Journal making the case for an extensive, the international community has to be prepared to make an extensive long-term commitment to Haiti. Could you imagine that one thing the United Nations would do is enshrine some sort of a new concept, what other, some people have called humanitarian intervention, but the idea of the legitimacy of involvement in countries such as Haiti, which can't sort themselves out, to help them essentially get back on their feet?
Yeah. No, that is a real question, but also a difficult one, in the sense that in recent decades, we've had several failed states. We've also come to realize that we cannot ignore these failed states, and failed states are not the problems of the citizens of that country alone, and that they eventually create problems for the whole world. A good example is Afghanistan. It came back to bite us, and we cannot sit back and see more and more failed states created. In the case of these failed states, including Haiti, there has been some suggestions that maybe UN should go back into the business of trusteeship. Right. That I'm not sure is going to fly. Most of the members of the UN were ex-colonies, and they'll be very, very nervous about reintroduction of trusteeship. If you're not going to be able to introduce trusteeship, it means we have to try and have effective early warning systems to be able to avert the crisis, the kind of crisis that we are seeing in Haiti. I think Haiti is an unfortunate experience because it's about the third time we are going in to try and do something, but it also means that we were not patient enough to stay in for the long haul. The sort of bandage approach, going in for a year or two to set up a weak police force, have elections, and think that's it, it's not going to work. This is why I feel this time we should be prepared to stay in for the long haul for 10 years or so to help the people of Haiti establish a really stable and a democratic institution, strengthen the institutions to be able to stand on their own. The real question is, what do you do when the preventive action fails? You have early warning systems, you try to prevent it and you fail. And we as an international community accept that we have a responsibility to protect the individual. The Canadians did a very good report titled The Responsibility to Protect, basically arguing that it is the responsibility of each government to protect its citizens, and they should see sovereignty in that sense, that they have a responsibility to protect the individual. In situations where the nation is either incapable, unwilling, or is in fact the government that is perpetrating these crimes, whether it's going to lead to genocide, ethnic cleansing, or gross and systematic abuse of human rights, what does the international community do? And if you are going to intervene to reverse these abuses, what is the criteria? Who decides? How do you determine it? And I hope the panel will give us some ideas building on the work that has already been done.
Yeah, that same report cited what it considered to be a real conundrum, where on one hand they said there's the duty to protect. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, they said we're not sure it's legitimate to exercise the duty to protect if the United Nations has not endorsed the intervention. And they basically said we're not sure what's more important. I'll be honest with you, I didn't think it was that close of a call.
Exactly.
And I would have thought the duty to protect took primacy over the other. And I didn't know where you came out on that.
No, I've made it quite clear. I mean, I've indicated that governments should not be allowed to use sovereignty as a shield to brutalize their own people. And when you have these sort of gross and systematic abuse of human rights, the international community does have a responsibility. But I think the report shouldn't be left there. They have posed the issue, and I think the member states should look at it and say, yes, if we have to do it, under what circumstances, under what criteria, and set up some guidelines that will facilitate transactions and decisions in the council for them to reach conclusions one way or the other, but hopefully in a positive sense to go in and protect those whose rights are being grossly and systematically abused.
I only have two other short, easy questions, and then we'll open it up here, if I might. I read the speech you recently gave in Japan. Mm-hmm. And the question, and even tonight you talked again about the possible need of changing the UN as an institution. Where do you see the entire debate over Security Council reform right now? Your favorite subject, I'm sure.
Yeah. I think there's lots of interest in Security Council reform in certain countries. Others are a bit more relaxed about it. But I think given what we went through last year, there's lots more support, I believe, for Security Council reform than had been manifested recently. I think it is not just the Japanese, the Germans, and others who want to see Security Council reform. I notice there are some regional powers, regional countries, countries with influence in their own regions, that also believe that they should have a say on global issues. I lived through a very interesting experience during the debate leading up to the Iraq War, where prominent countries who were not in the Security Council were really frustrated and restless in the sense that they wanted to make an input. They were not on the council, and therefore they couldn't really make an input and influence sense. In fact, one of them even suggested to me, Mr. Secretary General, why don't you organize a summit with a select group of leaders like us for us to discuss Iraq and see how we can make a contribution? And you would all recall the divisions that already existed amongst the membership at that time. And if I had convened a meeting of that kind, it would have seemed I was setting up a competitive Security Council, and that would have added to the divisions. But these are countries that we often tend to, countries who play very important roles in their own regions, countries from Brazil to South Africa to India and others, who would also want to see their voices heard. And I think these countries are very interested in seeing Security Council reform. Even though we are a nation of sovereign states, I think populations count. To have India with a fifth of the world's population not on the council is a bit difficult. And in fact, when you look at the statistics or demographics, the four permanent members, leaving China aside, US, United Kingdom, and France, and they represent 8.6% of the world's population. And they have four permanent seats on the council. India is absent, Brazil is absent, South Africa, Nigeria, and all the. So there's a real debate as to whether the council structure can be retained the way it currently is, or it has to be reformed and brought into the realities of today, and to reform it to make it more democratic, more representative, and thus gain in greater legitimacy, and for its decisions to be much more easily accepted around the world.
Let me stop there with my questions. As you know better than anyone, we started a little bit late tonight. Secretary General has graciously agreed to extend what was going to be our end time. What I asked with your questions, if you could make them particularly succinct tonight, that would give more people a chance to engage. And again, raise your hand, I'll recognize you, wait for the microphone and just identify yourselves, and we'll try to cover as many people as we can. Yes, ma'am. It's coming to you.
Hi, Claudia Rosette. Question about, as someone well informed, you know much in the news right now is the Oil for Food program. Yeah. It's a two-part question. Do you think that the placement of Saddam's business via Oil for Food influenced the Security Council debate? And
the placement of this, if it influenced the Security Council debate?
Yes, exactly. The discussion over France, Russia, the heavy tilt of contracts that way, did that influence the Security Council debate over Iraq? Mm-hmm. And also, there's evidence that Benon Sevan was taking favors from the Saddam Hussein regime. Could you tell us what you think he was being paid for with thanks?
Okay. First of all, you see what a leader he is. I never suggested I was go beyond time, but I agree with him. but he did it very nicely. I will stay for as long as you need me to. on your question, I'm not sure that the oil for food scheme influenced the debate in the council. And I think your question is if it influenced the decision whether to go to war or not. During that period, I had the opportunity of speaking to lots of leaders around the world, those who were for the war and those who were against the war. And I will tell you, they all held their views with conviction, and they were both sides were convinced that their position was the right one. The U.S. and those who wanted action saying, we cannot allow this to continue. Saddam has to go, and we have to go and disarm him. With the others saying, this is give the inspectors a bit more time. It's going to be very dangerous. Some leaders who were not on the council, like Mubarak, tell me if you do, you can't. There'll be terrorists everywhere. You won't be able to stop them. So there was genuine policy differences, in my judgment, during that period. It wasn't for economic or other reasons that sometimes one imputes. It may have been involved, but that was not my experience in my discussions with them. The discussions were so heated and so sincere that I didn't think anybody will waive his oil interest as a reason to hold back this issue. The oil for food scheme, as some of you may know, was a very complex process. You had a normal commercial transaction, and the UN superimposed on it administrative and legislative structure. The Iraqi government was allowed to offer contracts, negotiate contracts with companies, both for sale of oil and imports of goods. The contracts had to come to the 661 committee, which is a subcommittee of the Security Council, to review it, sometimes with the inspectors also looking at it, to make sure that they were not important items that could be used for weapons. The dual-use items were checked very carefully, and some items were put on hold for months. Once that had been cleared, the contracts went forward, and the payment was made through the escrow account that the UN held. All the revenues from Iraqi oil sales went into an escrow account, which was controlled by the UN, and the contracts were charged against these escrow accounts. And so it was a very sort of a complex, and that sometimes is difficult to explain in a very simple manner. And there was a period when the council felt that there were games being played with the oil prices and tried to do something about it. In fact, they came up with an approach where companies bidding for oil from Iraq got their contract, got the oil, didn't know how much it was going to cost. And they found out after the deal had been made, the idea was to prevent them from making deals on pricing and getting kickbacks. And that created its own problems. So anyway, we are investigating the allegations against the UN staff. The name of Benan Saban has been mentioned. It's an allegation that we are looking into. Our inspector general is looking at it. We are in touch with the coalition, the CPA, and the Iraqi Governing Council to get whatever evidence they have for us to be able to pursue it. And of course, we are also talking to the Security Council members to see if on the broader scheme there are other investigations we may want to conduct.
Ambassador Gardner.
Mr. Secretary General, the United States was the subject of an armed attack on 9/11. Under the UN Charter, do we not have the right, since we're at war with Al-Qaeda, to take preventive action against them wherever they're located? We're the nation state. is unwilling or unable to suppress them?
That's an interesting question. I think the fact that the U.S. was attacked and you were a victim was recognized by all the member states. And you would recall the spontaneous reaction of solidarity and sympathy, not just here around the world, candlelight vigils in cities around the world, and the Security Council and the General Assembly acted promptly in solidarity with the U.S., passed a very strong resolution in the Council insisting that governments should not give financial support, refuge, or logistical support to any of these terrorists. They must share information, they must cooperate across national lines, police work, and all that. And when it came to attacking Afghanistan and the Al-Qaeda in Afghanistan, there was no debate. In fact, nobody criticized the U.S. for doing that because it was recognized that was a legitimate act of self-defense. And not only did no one criticize, the Council passed resolutions allowing ISAF, the European troops and others to go in. The problem one has had with Iraq or one has had with the larger membership is the whole debate about Iraq was to rid Saddam of weapons of mass destruction. The debate in the Council was that Saddam had defied the Council. There were many resolutions that he should disarm and has not disarmed. And so one was going to go in there to disarm them. The argument before the Council was never to go in and eliminate terrorists in Iraq. It was never to go in and liberate Iraq. These are arguments which came up later, but it was not the basis for Council action, nor the basis for the divisions between the Council members. And so on the basic principle of a nation defending itself, I think I agree with you, and other member states will share that. Having said that, let me say that we are dealing with an unusual organization. We are dealing with terrorists who are nowhere and everywhere. And my own view is that to defeat them, we need to really get the member states to understand that it is in everyone's interest to work together to root out and contain these terrorists, and that we need to work across borders and pool our efforts to root them out. I don't think it is going to be possible for one country to move from country to country looking to attack terrorists. It is going to be extremely difficult, and it can lead to other problems, in fact, with the countries where they are hiding and others. And so I think force cannot be ruled out. There are moments when force has to be used, but the other instruments should also be brought to play.
Ted Sorensen. You got a microphone coming just behind you.
Mr. Secretary General, I'd like to ask you to reflect on the Office of Secretary General. The politicians and press of all the world are quick to ask you for a solution to every problem in the world and to blame you for every omission and error of the United Nations, but the Charter does not give you authority equal to that responsibility.
Yeah.
Will you ask the high-level experts panel that you have established to include in their recommendations increased authority for the Secretary General?
I think that would be the fastest way to kill their recommendations. I agree with you that I do get a lot thrown on my plate, particularly those difficult and intransigent problems. Those difficult and intransigent problems where governments feel we must do something, which is natural instincts, but often we are not sure how and what and with whom, then it's referred to the Secretary General. I think the Secretary General has also had to use, I've had to use my own initiative and judgment as to when I should take certain initiatives and action, engage the Council and the members at large on a particular issue or the other. And So far, it has worked reasonably well. I see some members of the council in the room. I see Ambassador Cunningham and others are here. I have been able to take initiatives and go to them, and I think perhaps it's best to keep it this way. If we try to define it and ask for more power, they'll probably try and tie the Secretary General up much more so than it would be wise. I think what is important is that the Secretary General should find a way of working effectively with the council, key members, permanent members of the council, and key constituencies in the organization to be able to move major agenda issues, to get them to focus on possible threats to peace and security, and to develop a relationship that will lead to not only a give and take, but a trust in the office that they would work with the Secretary General. I think proceeding that way is more effective and safer. Any attempts to define further the powers and the role of the Secretary General, I think will be not only be problematic, it will end up diminishing the role and the power of the Secretary General. So I prefer to leave it ambiguous.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, my.
Suzanne Nossel from BMG. The UN may face one of its most challenging and high-stakes roles ever if it goes into Iraq, as many expect, after the CPA pulls out on June 30th. In your mind, what are the prerequisites, both on behalf of the UN and on behalf of the membership, to making that mission a success?
It's a simple, straightforward question. Let me say that Iraq, indeed, is one of the most difficult challenges that we face. And when I say we, I'm not only talking about the UN, I'm talking about the international community. You may recall that on the 19th of January, I met here in New York with the head of the CPA, Bremer, and his and the British representative, Sir Jeremy Greenstock, as well as with seven members of the Iraqi Governing Council led by Mr. Pachachi. At that meeting, we discussed the way forward between then and 30th of June. The U.S. has decided to hand over power to the Iraqis on the 30th of June. They had two options. Some Iraqis wanted elections by 30 June to establish a new government. The U.S. had come up with a caucus system, which they preferred. We were asked to go in to determine whether elections were possible before end of June, and if not, were the caucus system possible, or could it be refined to make it acceptable? We concluded that neither elections were possible before the end of June, nor was a caucus system viable because it was too complex. Elections were not possible before end of June because you have no legal framework. You didn't have a political parties law, independent electoral commission, voter registration. So we would have to set all this up. And we have indicated that from the moment this legal framework is in place, you will need about 8 months to organize elections. So the earliest elections can be organized will be either end of the year or beginning next year. You then turn to but everyone wanted to retain the 30 June date. The US wants to retain it, the Iraqis want to retain it. And of course, once you've put out the date of 30 June for transfer of power to the Iraqis, you cannot take it back. You cannot postpone it. You know, it will create more problems as everybody looks forward to it. So now the key is to have a mechanism for establishing an interim government by 30 June to whom power could be transferred to by the CPA. The team that I sent in is prepared to go in again, but now that the Iraqis and the governing and the coalition have had time to digest their report, we wanted them to give us their reaction to the report we gave them after the first team went in, and to indicate if they want further assistance from us to help them design a mechanism for establishing the government by 30 June. I have indicated that we are prepared to go in and help if they so desire. And so they are discussing this amongst themselves, and I will hope to get, hopefully I will get a request from them. Once we go in, if they so desire, we will not limit ourselves to the efforts to establish a government by 30 June, but go beyond that and hopefully work with them to establish the legal framework for the elections that will be required next year, the national elections, to establish a fully fledged and internationally recognized government. So this government that is going to be established in June will be an interim government that will perhaps last for about 8 months or so until the elections, and the new government will take over. So the UN will be prepared to work with them on the constitutional issues, on the electoral, on the preparations for the elections and the actual elections. And of course, if the security situation permits, we would also work with them on institution building, human rights, humanitarian issues, and recovery and reconstruction. But for the moment, security is a real constraint. It's a constraint not just for us, it's constraint for reconstruction efforts, it's constraint for average Iraqis in certain cities. And so attempts being made to secure the environment are absolutely essential, because if we do not secure the environment, we are not going to be able to do all the wonderful things we've promised the Iraqis.
You have time for one more?
Sure.
Arthur Ross? Your staff tell me.
Secretary General.
Nobody's fine with me. You can even take a few more.
You referred in your earlier remarks to what happened in Madrid. Would you comment on the statement that Spain's new president made, that it would keep its soldiers there if the UN had a mandate? Wasn't too clear what he meant. Mm-hmm. Have you had any communication on that? How do you interpret that? Mm-hmm. And can anything be done on the matter?
Yeah. No, that is the Spanish position, the position of the new prime minister, let me put it that way, can pose a problem if it is not handled well. I think other European governments were in similar situations, in the sense that their populations were not for the war, but the leaders, convinced that it was the right way to go, went ahead and supported military action. If the situation in Spain is not handled well, we need to be careful that you don't have ripple effect and other reactions, similar reactions in other European countries. I think the reaction of the population or the Spanish voters is something that we need to accept. Let me put it this way. First of all, it's democracy. When you go to elections, you never know the outcome. I think there were several factors, in my judgment. There was a whole investigation and the feeling that at the beginning they were not getting the full story as to who was responsible and all that. Then, of course, when the statements came from the terrorists who committed the crime, or those who claimed to have committed the crime, linking it with the war, it revived the whole argument about the war and those who were opposed to it. And so I think it changed the dynamics of the elections. But I think it is extremely important that we all accept that the stabilization of Iraq is everyone's responsibility. We cannot, as an international community, afford to see a chaotic Iraq in the middle of that region. It can have impact on neighbors if it is not contained, and it can have impact on oil supplies and all that. So it is in everyone's interest to ensure that we work with the Iraqis to stabilize their country, to help them establish their democracy and move forward. When we talk of a UN mandate or UN involvement, it can mean several things. One, either the UN is on the ground in Iraq, actually playing an important role, or you have a Security Council mandate which authorizes governments to send in troops to help secure the environment. My own sense is that the Council would probably be prepared at the right time to issue a resolution that would encourage the establishment, that will establish a multinational force and allow other governments to participate in an international effort to pacify Iraq as part of our international effort. Whether that would be satisfactory for the Spanish government, I don't know, but I presume that sort of a mandate may suit their needs, but of course, it is a decision for the Spanish government to make. But this is the way I would see it.
Secretary General has generously given me a reprieve, so we can squeeze in one more question. Let me say in advance, I know I'm going to disappoint 40 people in this room and make 40 new enemies, but I'm tough and I can let. I feel the back of the room must be favored. I can't see you, but yes, ma'am.
Yes, could you envision that Janet Benchoff? Could you envision that a country like Burma, in which military or terrorists have kidnapped a legitimate democratically elected government, could you see labeling that a failed state and therefore authorizing Security Council intervention?
Let me say that we follow the situation in Myanmar very closely. In fact, I have an envoy who goes in periodically working with the government, pressing them to begin their democratic dialogue. In fact, he was seen earlier this month. He saw Aung San Suu Kyi and he saw the government, pressing them to release her and engage in serious dialogue. Your question is Myanmar at a stage where it can be leveled or declared a failed state, which touches on the issue or the definition of a failed state? Your question is the first time I've heard anybody use that term in relation to Myanmar. There are abuses. It is not democratic. The democratically elected leader has been under house arrest for a while. There are other problems. But is it a failed state along the lines of Afghanistan, Somalia, and others? I think that is going to be difficult to convince the member states in the organization to adopt that line. And so let me answer by saying, with all the difficulties that Myanmar has, and all the efforts we are making to get democratic dialogue going and to get Aung San Suu Kyi out of jail so that she can play her role, at this stage, I don't think it will be generally accepted as a failed state.
With that, let me deliver three thank yous. One is to all of you for your interest and for your patience. To Mrs. Morse, thank you for honoring us with your presence. And to the Secretary General for coming here tonight and for all he does in his present capacity. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.